especially main. Today is December 20, 2016, 5:07 PM, the regular meeting of Greensburg City Councils. At this time, I'd like everyone to silence any electronic devices they may have in the same for the pledge of allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Comply with Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the city requests that participants in this meeting complete a voluntary anonymous survey that is available on the table at the back of the room. And those surveys are sitting right there on that table as you exit. So if you would do so, please fill one out when you leave. Please call roll.
Tom? Mark? Kevin?
Here.
Jamie?
Here.
Bruce?
Here.
Roy?
Here.
John?
Here.
The minutes from the November 17th, 2016 meeting were emailed to all of us. Those minutes that were emailed had some marked changes on them. Has everyone had a chance to review those minutes? Do I have any changes or corrections to those minutes? Having heard that, I'd like a motion to accept the marked minutes as emailed.
So moved.
I have a motion, I have a second.
Seconds.
I have a second. All members in favor of the minutes as emailed and marked, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same side.
There's a mistake on the revised, and it's got 4 instead of 6.
Which line?
On the second page, number 4. Yeah, 9 went to 4. Correct.
2, 3, 4.
Should be title 9, not title 4.
Should be title 6.
Should be title 6.
Did I have IV?
IV.
You have 4 scan.
For the,
all right. Sorry. Yeah.
My bad.
Let's do this.
I'll rescind my second.
Go ahead.
I'll rescind the motion.
All right. Minutes that were emailed, that we have a correction on line number 4, where it says he has civil rights title. It's 4, let's make that 6. An additional change to the minutes as emailed.
They'll grow in numerals, there we go.
Yeah, we didn't do well in that, obviously.
Do I have a motion for that correction? Sure. I have a second.
Second.
All right. All in favor of the minutes as emailed with the additional correction that we just made, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same side. Therefore, we have corrected, approved minutes. New business, item number 1. Public hearing for the purpose of considering a petition for a primary plat of the proposed Parkway State subdivision located along the south side of Park Road from approximately 520 feet east of County Road 150 West to approximately 1,300 feet east of County Road 150 West.
Park Road is located here, County Road 150 West is located here, and the parcel under consideration is the one outlined here in orange. It's 14 point some acres. It is zoned R1. The proposal that I had received and submitted to the Planning Commission earlier, today we received additional information on that plat, and I have handed each of you revised documents that provide additional information. The information that you now have is in general compliance with our subdivision control ordinance for the primary plat. The one exception is that the stormwater management plan has not yet been developed, so that is not included at this point in time. And to that end, if you elect to approve the primary plat, and is my recommendation to you that it be approved with the condition that the stormwater management plan be submitted and reviewed and approved by my office prior to the secondary plat coming before you. There was a technical review held on this plat, and there were a few questions that came from that technical review. One was the fire department has asked to have two additional fire hydrants placed along the north side of Park Road, and the developer has agreed to installing those two fire hydrants, and there is now a note on the plat, generally on the right, towards the top of the page, there's a note there that says additional fire hydrants will be installed. There was a question that came up in regards to having adequate site distance for the driveway on the westerly lot. There is a slight crest vertical curve, a little bit of a hill to the west, and we wanted to be sure that there was enough site distance for vehicles to safely enter and exit that site. Andy Scholey, on behalf of the petitioner, provided me with some survey data, a profile of Park Road in that area, and I have been able to review that and determine that the available site distance across the front of that westerly lot is adequate for a driveway at that location. There was a question in the technical review committee about showing a drainage easement. There is a drainage swale generally along the southerly portion of those five lots, or that entire parent tract. The plat now shows a 40-foot wide drainage easement across the very bottom of that swale. And I believe those were the significant issues. Everything else on the plat, other than the stormwater management plan, conforms with the requirements of our subdivision control ordinance. This is before you as a primary plat. It will have to come back to you for a secondary and final hearing. You are this evening considering the general layout of the subdivision, I think, more than anything else. And you will have one further opportunity to resolve any issues that may not get resolved this evening.
Do any board members have any questions of Ron?
Bruce?
The swell that you're referring to would be back on the south side of the
generally park. Along through here, and you will see that showing
so
as
this is right here?
Yes, sir, that is the drainage easement. Stormwater management plan will actually address the reduction of the rate of discharge of stormwater from this site. Our stormwater control ordinance basically requires that a storm event be released from the site at a slower rate than the natural conditions. That was a gross oversimplification. But
members have questions, Ron?
Well, just a question real quick, and one of the BZA members had left the letter from the attorney here, I think, that they've got on this petition, and one of the issues, I'm just asking because I didn't get a chance, I don't think we saw this, but one of the questions in here asked the concern about the additional driveways off of Park Road, because there'll be five drives.
Actually, the proposal is that there will be three drives, that two of the drives in this area will be combined into one, and two of the drives in this area will be combined into two. But I must tell you, the city does not have a driveway ordinance, so we have no authority to tell people they can't put their driveway wherever they want. Other than this area in here, there is adequate site distance, which is the major consideration for appropriate locations. Vehicles can see and be seen. The speed limit on Park Road is 30 miles per hour, so it's not the fastest street in town. It may not be the slowest.
I just seen it on here, and I was just asking the question.
That has been...
There are several other properties that have a driveway.
There, out of the three, one driveway's already there where they tore the old Robles.
Please approach and state your name for the record.
Okay.
Easier on the minutes when they go back through.
Actually, there's three driveways will show, but there's actually only two driveways that'll be added.
Okay.
Because there's one already there that went to the Robles farm.
Larry, which one's already there?
The one that's already there runs about right here.
Okay, so it'll just be moved over to where those two...
Right.
The board members have any other questions? Having heard none, I'd like to ask if there's anyone from the audience who'd like to approach and speak to this issue.
I'm Dawn Barnes. I am the property owner here to the east of and all the way down to the south side of the property. We have all the water that goes through our back property that comes, and the guys have just done some drainage tile here, if you want to speak to them more technical about that. But there's a huge amount of water. I mean, we're not talking like a ditch, like the side of the road ditch. We're talking a huge amount of water that runs through there. And it just goes where it wants, obviously. apparently, Larry was showing me just briefly that he's done, this is what I had originally, so I don't have what you have.
Okay.
But apparently there's been some more work done to this, because that was my concern. That's why some more work was done, because there was no issue about the water at all. But you know what? Now I'm hearing you say that there should be something about the way the water releases slower.
The natural runoff of the
right.
water when it rains.
Okay, so what would that be, a pond to do
yeah,
that?
Yeah, I'm going to make this real simplified, it's not technical, but our ordinance says that basically the water that leaves the property after it's developed can't be any more than it was before it was developed. So whatever you have now, it can't, the hydrologist will have to make a study of this and let us know. We'll get that in the water management report, which we don't have right now, but that has to show, and I think it's a 10-year and a 100-year storm, that basically it can't be any worse than what it is right now. It can't make it worse. And he will have all kinds of facts and figures to prove that, and that's what he got his education in, and I tend to believe him because I have no clue whether they're telling us the truth or not, but I hope they do. But basically, that's in a nutshell.
My property will flood if not.
Well, I understand, Dawn. And we tend to take them at their word, and they develop things that will allow that to happen. And I don't know whether it'll be retention, or I can't say. I'm not.
Right.
I have no expertise in that area, so. But it won't be any worse. You won't see it be, your property won't become more inundated or more flooded than it is today. Whether it should be better, but I can't promise you that it will be better.
Well, our property is not flooded now that we've done the tile work.
Okay, well then it should
Because the property, who owns the property now? I think you're buying it on contract, is that right?
We own the property and Tom Kramer owns the property.
Tom Kramer gave permission for us to do the tile work through there. But my concern is that somebody starts moving dirt around to build a big outbuilding or whatever back there, that we're going to clog up that water.
Which is the reason we had the drainage easement added to the plat.
if that's where the water's running. Since we don't know that's exactly, because when you get past, you can ask them, they'll come up and tell you some more, but when the water runs back there, it kind of eases, it just kind of does its own thing when it gets, I mean, the natural flow is not, because there's no tile or drainage through there. So anyway, what I would like to ask is that you table this until you get the water study and get that part done. Because I'm really concerned about this, because if that water backs up, my basement is a swimming pool. And we're not city, we are county, and we are nearly 6 acres there next to this. And then I also wanted to just get it in the record that sometimes we have cattle back there, so I just want to make sure that the people who are going to be in these very nice homes, which I'm, that's great, know that they might have a mooing cow next door. Just put that in the record so everybody knows ahead of time. So.
Thank you very much.
Uh-huh.
I have a question, and I was talking to Andy about this earlier, and I guess
you want to address that.
When we have this, with the strategies we've shown on the plat, we have a 40-foot width. I guess my question is to Andy or to you guys is, what did you use to determine the 40-foot, and is 40-foot sufficient in case someone needs to get in there and do any cleaning up to ensure that there's no drainage issues?
I'm Steve Dickman. We installed a tile for Mr. Sturgeon and Mrs. Barnes in Israel. We went to the FSA office. It's about 110 acres. Surface water goes through that property area. And what we did is when we were contacting Mr. Sturgey, there was no originally good outlet to let the tile release the water from. So we got permission from Mr. Kramer to open a ditch about 150 feet to the existing ditch. Once you get to that existing ditch, you go to the west side of the property, the water just runs randomly. But I think Mr. Hammond's going to address making a ditch to improve that. Originally, there were existing clay tile in there. We don't know where they outlet, but there's trees that developed and created them to be no good any longer. And so what we've done is put riprap in. We've made a nice outlet for where the tile's at. We also put in a small dry dam up in the Sturgeon property to kind of keep some of the water from just flowing into it. And we also, along the radial property, we put a trickle drain to allow some of the old tile that comes through the radial property to go through the Barnes property underground. So the 40 feet is a minimum. I would like to have a little more, but that's, they asked what a minimum would be, and we did say 40 feet. So yeah, it would be tight for equipment to work, but sufficient.
What would be optimal for equipment to work?
45, 50 feet would be better. I mean, in that kind of situation, you would have to take like an excavator and dump it onto a truck to haul it to a different location. And if you've only got the ditch plus 15 feet on each side, it's a pretty small area. I mean, if you put the easement to the side of it where you'd have 10 foot the ditch and then the rest of the 40 feet, that would allow you better work area. You only have to work on one side of the ditch. In most cases, the is dry.
With this 40-foot easement, if someone had to get in there and work, and with the type of equipment that they would potentially need to get in there and work with, if they got outside that 40-foot easement, and I don't know, I guess I'm asking Ron or whoever can answer this, what's the potential legal liabilities or implications if someone's outside that easement with their equipment?
I'm going to get on that question right away because I want to turn to Chris and ask him what the potential legal implications are. I suppose that would be some form of trespass.
Property owner, whoever owns it, would have to take the action at that point. It's a violation of the court of easement.
If I ask my question again, is 40 foot sufficient? And I don't know, I have no clue what I'm asking.
I don't have any equipment. I asked, I met with Jeff Beggs that worked for Don Barnes, and like I said, that's what Jeff said would be a minimum. I don't know what, you know, everybody that does this kind of tile work is probably going to have a little different equipment. Some of them is going to be bigger or smaller. So.
I
are you guys just...
When we did this, we were just going... When we did this, we were just going off of kind of the information that we were given. I don't think back here, this is, it's, you're not going to see much, as steep as the drop-off is and the elevations back there, you're not going to see any construction. So people were buying this for privacy or having their own little private property that kind of butts up to the field. I don't think that, you know, if we needed a 50 or 55 foot, I don't think that's going to be that big of a deal. I mean, it's a pretty steep drop-off into the ravine.
So you would not be opposed to making the easement a 50, 55 foot?
I'm not the property owner, but I don't see why that would be a problem in the conversations that I've had with my dad. I guess I would get to Larry on that.
If we didn't develop the property at all, the situation would be what it is right now.
Absolutely.
If we develop the property, it'll be better than it is now. The lots that we have, the water we're going to be dealing with is their water, from the acres and off of their properties. There's the large flow. What we're proposing when we do our survey, I mean, do our hydrologist and that, we're not going to be adding anything to it. So what we're correcting is an age-old problem. We're going to put the easement in, we're going to shoot it, we're going to make sure that easement will take the water flow. If we have to make it a little wider, we'll make it a little wider.
The question I was leading to really wasn't involved with water flow. This is what happens if the contractor has to get in there, and do, if there is an issue and it has to be cleaned out or opened up, it's 40 feet sufficiently width that they can get in there and do their work without getting on the property owner's property.
Well, each...
The answer I got was that 40 is a minimum, but 50 to something else would be more often.
Each pro... Go ahead.
Go ahead. If I may, the situation is, it's your property that they're going to be fixing, okay? So I don't know why you would be upset. You know,
I know,
they're fixing your problem.
I know, but I've been on this board for 2 years, and it seems like every time someone else gets on somebody else's problem, there's potentially an issue.
Well, but there's, you can ask Chris, there's always that.
That area.
I don't know that we can fix that.
And if that area back there is so steep and is really not
maintained,
set up for...
I got a fix for it. We'll add to our covenants that each property owner will be liable and will have to take care of and keep the easement behind running through his property.
You can't do that.
That'll be in the covenant. So then all...
But then we go to the item 17 of your covenant. That ordinance overrules the covenant. I'm not going to get into another discussion with the covenant being law. I'm not going to do it. I did it with two other plats. To me, the simple fix is to make...
We'll just add another 10 feet on this.
Make it a 50 or...
Another 10 feet on the south side. That way they can bring their equipment.
Right. If they added... Because right now I've got this...
It's 50 feet of...
Yes.
Yeah.
This is a 40-foot easement that I've got centered on the center line of that ditch.
Okay.
20 feet each side. So why don't we add another 10 feet on the south side? This way there would be 30 feet on the south side of the ditch to allow... Would that be adequate for equipment? 30 feet on the south side, 20 feet on the north side?
Yeah, give me 50 feet.
That'd be a 50-foot easement? Because, I mean, there's not much else that's going to happen on the south end of all these lots. So would that take care of the problem? You know, get a 50-foot easement.
Yeah. I think what Kevin's concerned is, yes, somebody's building. Maybe you're in the middle of that. Somebody's coming here to do some work, and now you're terrible. Property, you know, and,
right.
You know, this problem needs to be addressed, but we're crossing over people's problems.
There is a coming up from the grid.
This is coming in resolved, and here's what we're going
to I think the offer that Andy put forward would be adequate to take care of just doing anybody's equipment and being able to move the dirt out. So that way you'd have a work area wide enough to bring equipment in.
And that's why I'm asking. I don't do that type of work. I don't know what type of equipment, how many equipment you potentially need. I just know that if you got, that at some point in time, if someone's in there working and they get on somebody else's property, potentially can be an issue. If we can avoid that at all costs at this point in time, I think we're all better off.
If they're satisfactory with that proposal, I would say, as a contractor, I would say
that would give you sufficient room to do whatever work you would need to do in that type of area.
I believe it would be.
Just about that 15 feet, could it be?
No, it's outside, it would be utilized couch anyway, so that's your call.
Yeah, what I mean, what I'm telling you, I guess.
You have 40, just take, make it 55 feet, put 15 on the south side.
I mean, the land's unusable anyway.
Right.
Down and back up to the cornfield.
So I'll keep it, the easement will be 20 feet on the north side of that ditch, and 35 on the south.
So I give you 55 feet, 55.
I'm okay, I just want to make sure that we have room to do what we see, be done, be done in the future without affecting somebody else.
We do have the ordinance that the property owners can impede.
Right, I mean, that's, yeah, nobody can impede or approach, you know, stop.
We saw the laws, what I'm talking about, it's in the covenant, they can't.
But Larry, I will give you kudos for this. Item 17 on your, no, item 17 on your covenant, thank you very much. Appreciate that. And I know I've talked to other people on this commission, they appreciate the fact that you added to that, that the city ordinances take priority when there's a covenant.
City ordinances always do, I mean, a covenant is put by the developer.
I know.
Covenants aren't even enforceable unless the developer himself enforces.
You know, we've had many discussions on that item, so.
I know, and you shouldn't have had, because it should, you know, it's basically, covenants are not city ordinances. Covenants are put on there by.
Appreciate it, do appreciate it. Are there any other items for the anyone like to discuss?
The only thing concerning, and it's kind of relevant, there are some old clay tile that go under that property. You know, if some hole or something were developed, you don't know whether that'd be an easement or not. I think Mr. Kent is very kind when he's saying, I'm just pointing out that old tile can cause problems. Currently, we feel they were plugged, and the water was surfacing on top of the ground. Who knows, you know, yielding something, it could change.
Thank you. Any other questions of board members? A second chance for anybody in the audience have any questions or comments or concerns? Having heard none, I would accept a motion to approve the primary plat, preliminary plat, as submitted with the change to the additional 15 feet on the south side to make a total of 55 foot for the drainage easement, and with the condition that a stormwater management plan must be performed and submitted to the engineering office prior to the second. Approved.
So moved.
I have a motion, do I have a second?
I made the motion.
Roy?
Roy and Jamie.
Jamie seconded.
Tom? Mark? Kevin?
Yes.
Jamie?
Yes.
Bruce?
Yes.
Roy?
Yes.
John?
Yes.
All right. Item number two, discussion of recommending the Greensburg City Council to pass an ordinance creating a building moratorium in the Veterans Way overlay district.
The Veterans Way / Memorial Way Overlay District Steering Committee met 10 days ago, something like that. Kevin sits on that committee and was at that meeting. It was a good organizational meeting, and one of the important things I believe that came out of that meeting was a recommendation from the steering committee that a moratorium on building within the overlay district be declared by the city until such time as the overlay district ordinance can be completed. I submitted to you and display here a map of the area of the moratorium. This area may or may not be the actual overlay district. The committee has not concluded that. This area is believed to be, if not the overlay district, probably slightly larger than the overlay district. And the committee recommends that an ordinance be adopted by the city council to prohibit any development and the issuance of any building permits in this district from the time of adoption of such a moratorium ordinance for a period of 6 months or until the council adopts an ordinance enacting the overlay district, whichever of those two periods of time would be lesser. There is somewhere around here a draft of a proposed ordinance if anybody wants to read through it. Chris has reviewed this, and not to put words in your mouth, Chris, but I believe you said you have no issues with it.
More copies if anybody.
There they are.
There they are.
I told you I had them.
I'm sorry. Wasn't listening to me, just figured I got one.
The reason this, Ron may alluded to this, but this came up as our, this came up at our planning meeting that, you know, we're sitting around talking about this area and potential benefits to the county, the city, for the growth of this area. And we're paying this contractor whose expertise is in overlay districts and, you know, what we can do in this area to maintain the items as a steering committee wouldn't want to maintain it. The last thing we wanted to have happen was, as we're working through this process through January, February, March, hopefully by April we'll have something ready to go to council, is for someone to walk into Ron's office in January and ask for a building permit because he wants to put X in a B3 zoning area. He goes out there and builds a Morton building.
And we have no authority to deny a permit if it satisfies our ordinances, so we have to issue it.
Nothing against the Morton building, but visually that's not potentially what's going to come out of this creation of the overlay district. I don't know what's going to come out of the creation of this overlay district, but potentially that could be a conflict to how we want buildings and sidewalks and lighting and signage and so forth to look along that way.
So if somebody didn't want to wait until, let's say they decided in January they wanted to put up a building, but they don't want to wait until June to start construction,
No, because if they got their building permit, wouldn't they be bound by the laws in effect at the time of the building permit issuance?
Well, not if we issued a moratorium. Right. So what I'm saying is there a way that they could come and maybe share what their project is, and maybe, I don't know if it fits what we're looking at for our overlay.
Well, all property owners along this area will have opportunities to participate in at least one meeting with creation of this. I forget which exact month that shareholders meeting is.
There will be a shareholders or stakeholders meeting along the way to discuss the concepts, and then certainly when the recommendations of the steering committee comes to the planning commission, that will be a public hearing, I guess. And then when it comes before city council, that will be another public hearing. I think, Jamie, perhaps your question was, if somebody has a hot project, is there a relief mechanism where they can, is that your question?
I mean, if we have an opportunity, and I hate to really turn it down or send somebody away because we're not gonna, I don't know what that is. And I hate to speculate on what that would be or could be, or maybe there's nothing, but is there a way that they could petition the system that, hey, we're still working on this, but how would we work through that? And I don't know what that is. I'm just thinking out.
Yeah, first off, as drafted, there is no relief provision in the proposed ordinance. It's hard and fast. You cannot develop your property until after, well, it says 6 months after the adoption of the ordinance, and it might, if you make a favorable recommendation this evening, this will go before city council on the 28th of this month at a special meeting for the first reading of the ordinance. If council takes a favorable position on the first reading, it will return on the 3rd of January for the second and final reading. So if that schedule should be implemented, then the ordinance would be in effect until the 3rd of July, I guess. So in that period of time, we would not permit any development or building, and as currently proposed, there is no relief mechanism established.
I mean, I know why, I get it. I think it's the right concept, just to make sure we have the importance for the money and do the effort in. We want to make sure that happens. I just...
One of the issues that I see, and I don't know how to get around this, until we write the ordinance, we don't know what the rules are, and the developer doesn't know what the rules are. And it is a process to work through to figure out what the appropriate set of rules need to be.
Is this an ordinance we can suspend the rules on?
Potentially, I think we could, but it's one of those things that, I don't know if that's what we want to invest with.
If you all, if you as council meet on the 28th and then again on the 3rd.
I guess here's where I'm going, if we can suspend the rules on that. Because let's say something comes up 3 months, 4 months from now, and we want to make an exception, then we could amend the ordinance. And then if we amended the ordinance, we could do it and suspend the rules and amend the ordinance all in one meeting, versus taking 2 months to do something if we needed to push something through. That's why I'm asking.
Yeah, you're asking the other side of the question.
I'm asking the other side, so if we pass this as is.
The other end.
Yeah, if we pass this as is and then we need to amend it later on.
If we're going to do that, why even have it?
Well, but it would be, I'm not saying we would, I'm just...
Because we'd be amending, because until the overlay district's done, we wouldn't know what the design criteria would be in that district, so they...
Chris and I kind of had this discussion earlier, and Chris points out that one of the forms of relief that's always available is the courts. And somebody could go to court and ask for relief from the ordinance, and quite frankly, that process would probably take as much or more time than waiting out the 6 months.
Right.
Most of the relief mechanisms that could potentially be available, since we're only looking at 6 months and hopefully maybe 5 months or 4 months if it all comes together, the 6 months was intended to be slightly pessimistic, so that if we have any unanticipated delays, we can still get done within the 6 month period. Most of the relief forms take enough time by the time you advertise and hold hearings or whatever that, you know, pretty soon there's a couple months gone and you're back to the same point.
We have a huge investment in that area out there. When completed, grand opportunities there for someone in the future to have a great building site. Overlay districts have been using a lot of communities to better control how those areas are developed. I don't want this to come out and say I don't want anything built. I think the sooner we get some stuff in there, I think it's better for everybody to sit, but you'd hate for something to get thrown in there and then it is
not
what you expect, and it potentially could inhibit other developers from wanting to build in the area.
What if a major corporation would want to come in, you know, like, say, like,
CVS, there was a BZA case, CVS, I talked to them a year plus ago. They're just now getting towards putting the proverbial spade in the ground. Bigger commercial developments takes months to develop.
Ron, years ago when we were working with Menards, that was an extremely drawn out process when they were going to go over by Walmart.
Probably the greatest inconvenience to potential developers of doing this is not that we tell them they can't start building in the next 6 months, because the project development probably exceeds that. The problem is we're writing the rules, and we haven't written those rules yet and won't for a few months. And so they can't do effective planning because they don't know what the criteria is going to be until we finish that process. And I don't see any shortcut to that process. We have to do the work, and we want to be diligent in getting the overlay district ordinance created, but we don't want to be in such a hurry that we don't do a good job. So it's a balancing act of putting in the work, but doing it as quickly and properly as possible.
The planning on these things since I've been around this has been every major development that's come into this community since I've sat on these boards going on 20-some years now. It's been at least a year minimum, and people like Ron know about it probably 6 months before that. Ron, the first hit we had of CVS was over a year ago, wasn't it?
Yes, they had come and they shared some issues they had because they had tenants as part of that property and they had to notify the tenants and they asked that it be held confidentially. But because of their processes, it's taken this long. And I was trying to think, there's somebody else I've talked to and I can't quite call to mind what it is, but it's somebody we've talked to and they're wanting to do something with their property, but it's been a while and it takes a bit for these things to happen. The other side of this double-edged sword is that many developers, and especially the better, higher quality developers, appreciate the assurance of knowing that if they put in a quality development, that their neighbor is also going to put in a quality development, and their development is not going to be detracted from because of what their neighbor does. And I think and hope and believe this is why we're doing this, is that it's a sales tool. It's a way to get better quality development because people can have confidence that it's going to be a good neighborhood to be in.
So the overlay district, once we kind of have the idea of what we want, does that get approved by the council?
It will be an ordinance. It is effectively, well, it's an overlay because it's additional zoning requirements that defined area that you have to comply with in addition to our zoning ordinance. And in some cases, there might be some relief granted through the overlay district from the zoning ordinance where it's advantageous to everybody involved.
Are there some buildings already in some of there?
Yeah. Yes.
So we, yes. We may
grandfather there.
Well, obviously we cannot go back and tell somebody they gotta do something, but if they want to make improvements in the future, and our ordinance really needs to address remodeling and that sort of thing as to how much improvement they have to come up with.
But they wouldn't have to confirm the form right now, right?
There isn't anything right now. They only have to conform to our existing ordinance. It doesn't go back and address. Whatever's there is there, and it has to be. It'll be there for you.
Unless they want to remodel or add on to.
Right.
Unless they make an improvement.
And we want our overlay ordinance to offer some guidance on how these things work. I do want to point out, I've given you a drawing that shows an area, and if you read section 2 of the ordinance, it lists a whole bunch of property ID numbers. It is intended and believed that those are the same. However, if the ordinance identifies the property ID numbers, and if there are any discrepancies, the map does not govern the list of property ID numbers, is what you would be recommending. Yes. I believe them to be the same. They were intended to be the same. But if there are any discrepancies, the list of property IDs are what you would be regulating. And at the end of the overlay district steering committee's work, the boundaries of the overlay district may not perfectly match this particular area. Could be larger, could be smaller, could be the same.
Personally, I think it's something that we need to make sure we recommend the council. Council will have to take action on it. It would be my recommendation if we wholeheartedly present this to council.
I think so.
Yeah, I think so. Where is the 6 months at in this ordinance? I'm just trying to
under section one, the approval of any development and durations of any building permit in the designated corridor area of the city of Greensburg, Indiana, as defined in this ordinance, is prohibited, one, for 6 months from the effective date of this ordinance, or two, until final action on the recommendation by the city.
Awesome. I must have skipped there too quickly, so thank you.
Whichever occurs first.
Awesome. Okay.
Anyone from the audience have any discussion on this item? So I'm hearing favorable to recommend, favorable to recommend.
Favorable.
All right, so do I guess I need a motion?
So moved.
I have a motion to recommend to city council this ordinance. Do I have a second? I have a second. Is it 32 or 33?
It is whatever it needs to be. I thought I had checked that. Chris assures me that we've already used 32.
I think we have used 32.
So if it needs to be 33, it will be, by the time it gets to council, it'll be whatever it needs to be.
John, please.
This one?
Yes, please.
John?
Yes.
Roy?
Yes.
Bruce?
Yes.
Jamie?
Yes.
Kevin?
Yes.
Mark and Tom.
Presented on the 28th city council. All right, item three, report from planning director.
I had first thought that there was a strong possibility that Park Estates subdivision might be back next month on secondary plat approval, but I had a discussion with Andy, and there's, because of the stormwater management plan and the work necessary to accomplish that, and the holidays get in the way of most everything right now, it may be that it'll be February before that comes back. There is no other business I am aware of, so there may not be a January meeting. That was one item. Unsafe buildings. We've had a number of complaints recently about trash, but that's not an unsafe building issue. We are still monitoring a couple of the ones that have been around for a little bit. And I confess that I've been a little bit busier more recently and haven't been as attentive to that as perhaps I should be, and hope to get back into that a little more. We do have a fire damaged building on Carver Street at 7th, and we need to, I need to do a little more thorough investigation of that situation and make sure it is a safe property. And it's my inclination, preference to give people a little bit of time to recover from their catastrophic event. They've had a little bit of time now, and we need to make sure they're doing the right thing. So I think at the moment that's kind of what's going on in my world.
Any other items of interest from planning commission members?
I have a question about the zoning issue. A long time ago, and we might have addressed this, but at one time when the zone was put in these areas out there for that Veterans Way area, I don't know if that might have been prior to this administration this morning, but because I didn't play a lot of that. The zoning is put in place for those pieces of property out there. Are we happy with that, the way that that is set up? Or was there some concern about that that
I can tell you that there is some B3 property out there. B3 is heavy commercial. And you can put a truck terminal in B3. Do you want a truck terminal along Veterans Way?
No.
This is a part of the overlay district concept. Without changing the zoning, and it could be appropriate to change some of the zoning. I don't know that we need B3 in that area. B2 might be what we need there. But the intent of the overlay district is to look at ways to enhance the quality of the development, regardless of what it is. And I guess what I will assign you, Bruce, for your homework is to read the B2 uses and the B3 uses, and the difference is, if my best example is R4 and R3. If you carefully read those two zoning districts, what you will find is the only difference between R3 and R4 is as a spatial use, mobile home parks are permitted in R4. Otherwise, R3 is the same as R4. And so if there are uses in the B3 that are inappropriate, then the Plan Commission should make a recommendation to council to rezone. If we believe that the overlay district will add, if there are some uses in B3 that are not included in B2, and they seem to be appropriate and or desirable, then we, I think, rely on the overlay district ordinance to make sure we don't get the stuff we don't want.
That's what the overlay district's going to intend. It's to better suit the type of business that we want in that area.
It could be that. It may not be that. It could just be, it could talk about, you know, a lot.
Landscape. It could even be the landscape.
Some architectural improvement. Different signage requirements.
Green space requirements.
Yes.
So there will be discussion on the B2, B3 zoning districts. So that's part of it, as we're going through.
There are some residential zoning out there along the east side of Moscow Road, north of Veterans Way. I personally think some residential is appropriate, but you know, maybe not there. Maybe that's something that ought to be considered. Maybe it ought to be moved somewhere different. I don't know. I'm not saying it does. I'm just saying that we can always look at those situations. We need to review our comprehensive plan, and comprehensive plan is an interesting process because it's intended to guide us into the future, but it's also a little bit reflects on what's already there. We didn't write the plan just because something was there, but we didn't ignore something that was there in writing the plan. So in that light, it may be a bit chicken and